Our world is an amazing, complex living organism, and we coexist in a symbiotic relationship. With this great power comes a great responsibility, a responsibility to ensure the future by taking steps to be sustainable today.
Sustainable Today is being made possible in part by Greenhammer Building Contractors in Portland, Oregon. Endura Wood Products. Find wood products for today and tomorrow in Portland, Oregon.
By the Center for a Sustainable Today. And now here are the hosts of Sustainable Today.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us again on Sustainable Today. We're so glad you could join us. This time our show's about toxins in everyday products that may end up in your body, so I think you'll find the show really interesting. I'm Darcy Hitchcock.
And I'm Marcia Willard.
And this evening we have on the show with us Molly Chidsey from Multnomah County. Thanks so much for joining us today. Before we get into the show, let's, the meat of the show anyway, shall we talk about the news segments that we came across? It seems like every time we talk about climate change, it's been such an important topic lately. And this time there's some more bad news, I'm afraid, and that is there's a new study out that shows that the rate of the greenhouse gases increasing has actually accelerated they looked at the period during the 1990s and then from 2000 and 2004, and it's increased significantly during that time.
Why is that? I thought we were paying attention to this. Why is it going up?
Well, part of it's because of China. They're obviously industrializing, and a lot of their power is coming from coal-fired power plants, which generates a lot of CO2 and lots of other pollutants as well. So that's upsetting. And, you know, the entire world just keeps gobbling up more and more fossil fuels.
Now, in our last show, we bragged a little bit about what Portland is doing, and we've been able to reduce our carbon emissions by a little bit. Is it going down anywhere besides Portland?
Well, it's interesting. The article that I saw listed different parts of the world, and some of them were growing very fast, like Asia, including China. Mm-hmm. But it looked like in Europe it was level or just a little bit down. So where there are good policies, where there are people who are paying attention, you can still have a very fine economy and be able to control climate change. We showed that
so
here.
That's the important news, is that it's possible to do without doing damage to the economy or our lifestyles.
Yeah, exactly. Well, so what did you come across?
Well, we have the solution to your problem.
Oh, good.
I noticed that in Oregon here that legislature just passed an energy bill that's going to require 25% of our energy to come from renewable resources by 2025. But 25% is very demanding. There are 23 other states that have similar legislation, but I think Oregon's is one of the highest percentages. So maybe we'll see different report in that research that you encountered in a couple years.
Well, I certainly hope so. I also came across a number of different news segments that relate specifically to our topic about toxics. One that I saw was around common chemicals are now clearly linked to breast cancer. The rate of breast cancer has been increasing, and there are more than 200 chemicals that are found in the air and in products that we use all the time, and they've found that they do cause breast cancer in animal tests. And I didn't realize this, but breast cancer is the leading killer of U.S. women in their early 30s to 50s. The leading killer. So it's serious. You know, we keep having the race for the cure. We need the race for the prevention.
Yeah, and that's an interesting statistic about it being the number one killer, because heart disease is also on the rise within women and other populations. So
one of the things that I found worrisome is that almost all of the chemicals that they were talking about are mutagenic, which means they change the DNA. So it's not just it makes you sick, but you can pass it on to your children. It's now changed, and that's very scary. There's also a Yale study that showed that even though the air quality on the East Coast was in compliance, there were enough toxins that affected the birth weight of women's babies, and obviously low birth weight leads to all these other health problems mm-hmm. that happen after that. So even though we're, you know, the EPA says it's fine, it's not fine. We need to be concerned about that.
Well, they're in compliance with the things that we know about.
Yes.
And now we're learning about a lot of different things. So I found some articles that answers the question how they get into your body.
Oh, that's good to know.
There were a couple of articles that I found about what's showing up in our water system. And one article talks about the impact of, in particular, the PCBs, which we've talked about on previous shows, which are flame retardants. I'm not going to try and pronounce the chemical name. But they're showing up in water, and the article is about the threat to wildlife, particularly birds.
But it seems like we haven't learned a thing since Silent Spring. I mean, Silent Spring, when did that come out? In the 60s, the book that, you know, was saying DDT was killing off stuff and it was accumulating in all of these animals and working up the food chain, and it seems like we've just changed chemicals.
We have. And you know, if, even if you don't care about the osprey that they're targeting, it's like the canary in the coal mine. I mean,
right.
we're getting the same thing, too. And then the other article is about our local rivers, and it lists the eight local rivers where they tested for some of these chemicals. And you know, just some interesting things about, yes, we do drink a lot of coffee. And now we have the proof that caffeine is showing up in the water, which doesn't sound too dangerous, but when you look at these other chemicals listed, they're mostly pharmaceuticals. Of the 13, almost half of them are mood-altering, antidepressants, and things like that.
So at least the fish are having a good time.
Yes. Well, they should be because they're also being feminized, so they're not having a good time in the other sense of the word. So we're changing.
So the women's movement has finally made a difference.
Well, we may get our wish for a world without men, I don't know.
Anyway, let's bring Molly into the conversation since she actually knows what she's talking about.
So thanks for being on the show, Molly. Would you? You're representing Multnomah County today for us, and so would you tell us a little bit about your position there and
sure.
the work that you're doing for us?
Of course. I work for the Multnomah County Sustainability Program, which is a pretty small program primarily focused on making county government operations more sustainable. So we work on a wide variety of projects ranging from green building for county facilities like libraries and health clinics. I work primarily on toxics reduction for how we own and operate facilities. I also work on recycling and some sustainable purchasing stuff. So today you're going to tap my brain about what I know and would like to share with you about toxics and toxics reduction.
Great.
We're eager to hear it.
Well, you know, when I first found out the synthetic chemicals that are in our bodies, I was so shocked. We have fire retardants, we have industrial mm-hmm. solvents, we have wood preservatives, we have, you know, all of these things in our body. And at the same time, life expectancy seems to be increasing. So I can't figure out whether we should be concerned or not with all this stuff that's in our body. So there's this term I've heard, body burden, which mm-hmm. talks about what's in our body. Tell us a little bit about that and what you know about it.
Okay. Well, you know, toxic chemicals can be either man-made or human-made, or they can also be naturally occurring. But those do often get into the human body, sometimes through water, like you talked about before, but we can also inhale them, or we could sometimes get them through the skin, through products that we use or things that we touch. So there's multiple different pathways. The term body burden actually just refers to the total amount of those chemicals that are in the human body at any one time. So it sounds a little bit gross, and it is, and it really does vary from person to person. There's been some good studies recently that show what those kinds of chemicals are, but the scientists really do, what we do know is that everybody alive today has some of these toxic chemicals in their body in very, very low amounts, but mm-hmm. it's kind of the accumulation of all of them. What's the soup that's, you know, what could they possibly do together? The synergistic effects aren't well known. There can be up to 700 chemicals in somebody's body at any one time.
700 chemicals.
Mm-hmm.
So where are they coming from?
Well, we're not really sure. They come from products.
Got some here.
Yeah,
actually.
I do have some here. There's, the main point is that we don't really know for sure.
Tell us about some of these.
Absolutely. Well, what you've got in your hand there is a very common household product.
I have some myself.
Yes, I know. I recently had to give up one that I loved myself. It's just a nonstick pan. It has a coating on it that, when heated at high temperatures, can actually is toxic in a way that might kill a small bird if you had a bird for a pet. It also, wow. So you talked about canary in a coal mine, it's kind of the modern version of that.
Okay.
That's something that we're working on.
And these, we've got 3 minutes, so I'm rushing you. Oh, my gosh, when you touch it.
Yeah, these are the blinky shoes. Sometimes they have a mercury switch inside, very popular item. This is a...
And mercury causes brain damage, right?
Yeah, mercury is a neurotoxin. It's pretty potent, and a lot of people know about mercury, but you don't know it might be in your shoes. So, yeah. They're still on the shelves out there. A lot of water bottles have a plastic
Everybody I know carries one of those.
They're very popular. It's made from a plastic called polycarbonate, and it's good for lots of things. It's very hard and durable, but when it becomes scratched or old, it can actually leach toxic chemicals into the water or beverage inside.
So like when I put it in my dishwasher, I'm doing damage that...
Yeah, you're damaging the integrity of the plastic, essentially.
And then my favorite, the vinyl shower curtain.
Yes, this is pretty common, and you know, the reason why vinyl is very soft is because it contains a plasticizer called phthalates, and those off-gas, that yucky new shower curtain smell is actually phthalates. So I brought these in today because they're pretty easy to find less toxic alternatives for that are pretty affordable as well.
I've heard that a vinyl shower curtain loses half its weight in the first 3 months that it's hung.
Huh.
Because of what it's off-gassing.
Mm-hmm.
And so there is no way it goes into the air and into your lungs and onto the dust motes that, you know, find their way around your house.
Hold
and
your
so
breath
forth.
When you shower. That's...
Right.
So I thought we had governmental agencies that protected us from all this stuff. So what's the deal there? We've got about a minute.
Okay. Well, I'll tell you, you know, we do have some federal policies like U.S. Toxic Substance Control Act. It's a little bit of an older policy from 1976. And it does a lot of good, but it doesn't require that chemical companies perform basic health and safety tests on their products.
Yeah.
So it's a really exciting time now because other countries are starting to step up to the plate and develop new policies like the European Union REACH policy actually just went into effect today. It's a very exciting day. Yeah, June 1st, 2007. So that's been in negotiations for a while. And the really exciting thing about REACH is that you know, chemicals used in products will have to undergo basic health and safety testing. And then there'll also be more information available about those products. So REACH stands for Registration, Evaluation, and Authorization of Chemicals. Seems like some common sense stuff.
I think most of the public would be shocked to know that this doesn't already go on, that we don't test products. The bias is that it must be safe until it's proven otherwise, and that's led to all of these problems that we have now. Well, you know, children are really an important issue here because they're little, they eat, you know, the amount of stuff that they eat, for example, per body weight is much different than an adult. They're growing, and so all those things are important. So we'd like to take you to the Oregon Environmental Council because they have this great new program called Eco-Healthy Childcare. The goal is for Oregon children to live and play in a toxic-free environment. And so this program encourages businesses and governments to reduce the use of toxic chemicals. It also helps parents and caregivers make choices that will protect their children from toxic chemicals, even before birth. We need to do that the same way that we protect our children from smoking and so on. Declines in asthma, learning disabilities, cancer, and other health problems that can be triggered by pollution are some of the things that we can fix through doing this. This is an extensive program that's won awards, and April Westfall will explain the program for us.
We are at the Rowanberry School in Northeast Portland. And with me here is Sarah Leverett from the Oregon Environmental Council, as well as Angela Malloy Murphy, founder and teacher here at the Rowanberry School.
And thanks so much for coming today, April.
Oh, thanks for having me. And we are here because the Rowanberry School has been chosen as an eco-healthy school by the Oregon Environmental Council. And I'm very curious what some of the standards are and why they might be important.
So the Eco-Healthy Childcare Program, it focuses on childcares as well as schools like Angela's, and it rewards and endorses facilities that are committed to reducing kids' exposure to toxics. And the program works by facilities looking at a list of 25 best practice points And if they comply with 20 of those 25 points to reduce kids' exposure to toxics, we endorse and promote them as eco-healthy.
Great. Well, I would love to take a look at the school here and see how the school has met those standards to be an eco-healthy school.
Let's check it out.
All right.
Come right along.
This is the entryway, and this is where we take our shoes off.
Oh. And why do we do that?
The reason for that is it just doesn't bring contaminants into the school environment. I think it's one of the points on the OEC checklist.
Yeah, it is one of the points. It's a great way to keep dust and contaminants out, as well as lead, which is a big issue in Portland. Older homes that have been painted with lead will, as they deteriorate, generate lead dust. And so as you're trekking around outside, you'll bring that in. And lead, of course, is very harmful to developing brains.
So it can actually stick to your shoes.
Yeah, wow. Yeah. Uh-huh. And depending on how much lead paint has been used in that area, or if it's near a traffic zone, you can actually bring in a significant amount.
No kidding. Wow, well, that's good to know. I think I'll start doing that at home.
All right, let's come on in.
All right.
This started out as just a really unusable basement, and wanting to have a home school, my husband helped me. He was the contractor and the builder, and he helped us build it from the ground up, literally. And because he has the same values as myself, and we have children of our own, he used as many natural and non-toxic materials as he could. So the paint is low or no VOC, depending on the room.
I noticed you don't have any wall-to-wall carpeting either.
Yeah, we try to avoid the carpeting because of all the off-gassing. The rug that we're sitting on is a wool rug.
It's all wool. Wonderful. And why wool over a regular carpet?
The big benefits to wool is that there is no off-gassing. It's naturally flame retardant. It naturally is antimicrobial, so it's a cleaner product naturally instead of having to add a lot of stuff to it. It also won't trap, not having the wall-to-wall carpet, it won't trap a lot of the dirt and dust and things that get dug in from outside. So when the kids are down on the floor playing, they're not going to have a lot of the particles coming into their lungs.
So I'm noticing that these toys, they look like they're all wooden. Is that right? I'm wondering why you might choose wooden over the, you know, the conventional typical plastic toys that we usually see.
The thing with these toys is they are an investment to begin with. I hear a lot of people say that they don't feel that they can afford wooden toys for their school or for their home, for their children, but it's an initial investment, but the toys really do last forever. Mm-hmm. If they break, they can be fixed, unlike a lot of times if plastic toys break and it's manufactured, it just goes in the garbage.
That's right.
And not only is it made with wood and painted with natural paint, but it's sealed with beeswax instead of polyurethane. And it takes a little more maintenance with toys like this. I have some natural sealant to go back and periodically continue to seal it so it's not affected by moisture. But you can smell the beeswax on a lot of these natural toys when you're playing with them. And it's really a beautiful smell. I think plastics are thought of as something that can be cleaned, that can be washed and disinfected really easily, and that's why they are used so much in childcare environments, mm-hmm. because they can just be run through the dishwasher. Mm-hmm. But we do wash all of our wood toys.
Uh-huh. And what do you wash them with?
Well, a little bit of grapefruit seed extract, and mm-hmm. just scrub it and then get it right out of the water and let it air dry.
Nice.
Some things like this they just eventually break down.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas something like this never will.
Right.
So this is the most plastic we have in the room is for the tactile tub because this stuff just sits in water.
Uh-huh.
But I'm starting to find more and more steel things, and I see this a lot in childcare centers. We've got a ton of plastic for our water play. But I'm finding more and more that there are things we can replace those with.
Oh, nice.
That aren't plastic at all, that will hold up to the water.
What you're looking for with plastics is avoiding number 3, number 7, and number 6. Number 3 is going to be PVCs, and the ones we're concerned about are the softer PVCs. Mm-hmm. So like a rubber ducky frequently will be number 3 and will have something called phthalates in it, which is not good for kids. You can identify number 3 by the soft vinyl.
Mm-hmm.
Number 7, hard, clear plastic.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. So it's like in sippy cups, for example.
Sippy cups and baby bottles. Some of them have them. But same price, same function. You can get ones that are milky or opaque colored that don't have, in number 7, it's bisphenol A, which again is increasingly linked to health issues in children. And the hardest part is that it's hard to tell which toys are the safer plastics, mm-hmm. because manufacturers aren't required to label it. And mm-hmm. also, depending on where it's from, you know, if a toy's made in China, a lot of times all the ingredients, it doesn't even occur to them to include that in the process. Mm-hmm. A lot of toys these days aren't made with the 3 or the 7. Some bigger companies are committing to not using bisphenol A or number 3. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you do have to be aware of it, and it is up to the consumer to really find out. Unfortunately, sometimes that means calling the manufacturer and asking because they aren't labeled, mm-hmm. Or choosing products that are explicitly labeled.
This is my 16th year as a teacher, and I've had plastic dolls the whole time because children love all over them, and they get really germy, and it's really easy to just sponge those down. And they were the soft, squishy kind, just like what you're talking about. And it's only been in the last couple of years that I've gotten these guys. They are wool, mm-hmm. and so they actually retain the child's body heat. They sure just treat soft. Them in a really different way than they treat those plastic dolls. And we're able to just sort of sponge bath them and treat them with a lot of care to make sure that they stay clean.
They hardly look used at all. I mean, wow.
They just treat them very gently. Mm-hmm. Just watching the way children treated those plastic dolls, you know, they ended up outside or thrown down, and they really treat these like treasures because they are. They are obviously handmade by people. And I think they watch the way I treat them as well, and mm-hmm. so they get the sense that it's really something to be revered. Mm-hmm.
So, Angela, you spoke about using non-toxic cleaners to clean the toys and the classrooms. So I'm wondering if you could tell us a little bit about what you have here.
Sure. This is the stuff I wanted to show you because it's pretty easy to get access to these things, to come across them. This is grapefruit seed extract, and you can get it at a health food store. And you can, if you smell it, it's a really strong, concentrated citrus that can be used to disinfect toys or to clean with or to wash dishes with. This is our soap. We just make our own spray soap for the children to use on the table. This is surface spray, and this is what we use to spray the room. It's an all-purpose antibacterial spray that's herbal. And you were talking before about things, Glade-type disinfectants that you plug in the wall or candles that you burn?
No, they both use chemicals that to bind scents that aren't good for especially developing lungs, but also they frequently put out small particles that can get deep into lungs and even pass over into your blood, so it's better not to use them.
And this just smells better. This is cinnamon and eucalyptus and tea tree oil.
And another thing people do is just boil a pot on their stove nice. With water and apples and cinnamon just to make the whole house smell like, you know, something tasty.
And Dr. Bronner's is for everything.
And that's mostly a Castile soap, is that right? Liquid Castile soap that's natural?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And we can use this with a little bit of water to dilute it, not much, just for the children to wash their hands with in the bathroom. And these are the products that we use to seal the toys. And this is just pure liquid beeswax. And it's a little different than just melting down your own beeswax to do it, as we discovered. It's just formulated in such a way that it's nice and liquid, that it's going to stay liquid. And you can use it to seal any unfinished toy or sand an already finished toy and reseal it with this.
And as you mentioned earlier, there are a number of recipes people can make on their own using baking soda and vinegar, borax, lemon juice, things like that. So going back to, you know, what our grandmothers did in cleaning, you can both save money and have a lower toxic cleaning regime. Mm-hmm. Chemicals are used in pretty much everything we do these days. In a childcare facility, art supplies, you know, the smelly markers that, you know, smell like orange and blueberry and what have you that I loved and played with as a child, turns out can be an asthma trigger and does interfere with lung development.
These are the watercolors that we use. The paint is plant-based or plant-derived. It's not completely derived from plants. There are other brands where the paints are completely from plants. Mm-hmm. This has other elements to it, but it is completely natural. Like the crayons we use are non-toxic, just like any of the crayons you'd get in a grocery store are non-toxic, but the difference is it's made with real beeswax rather than a petroleum-based product. You just actually smell the beeswax as you're coloring with them, and it's just something really subtle. We may associate doing art more with the scented markers you mentioned earlier, the scents of our childhood, but they say that smell is the closest link to memory, and when children are doing this, they are setting those patterns, natural smells, as things that smell beautiful and right to them, and then they'll recreate those in their patterning when they're buying art supplies for their children.
Well, I think Angela's done a really fantastic job. On our checklist, our best practices covers everything from non-toxic cleaners to air quality issues, inside and outside the facility, playground equipment we make recommendations on. Unfortunately, a lot of wood is treated with something called CCA, which is meant to prevent the wood from rotting or from pests from getting in it. But this product or this chemical actually leaches out of the wood and it leaches arsenic. So when kids are playing with it, they are playing on equipment that is leaching a chemical, which they then get on their hands. And then if they go and eat, they'll ingest the arsenic, which of course is bad for them in a lot of ways. Fortunately, there are a lot of great alternatives that don't cost more and are just as good for building play structures. In particular, cedar. It's a wood that naturally is rot and pest resistant.
It was made for children, so of course it's safe or safe enough. It should be fine. And then around the time we were doing the OEC standards, looking down the checklist, I realized that we had an opportunity to seal it with non-toxic sealant. My husband added this element up here for the treehouse and the sandbox, and as it grows and we add wood to it, we just purchased a non-toxic sealant, and so now the whole thing has been sealed with that instead.
If people have a pest control problem, they'll frequently defer to a toxic pest control.
But there's really no need for pesticides in the garden. What we do is plant companion planting. We have some slug catchers here. They love to eat the slugs. If we catch the slugs, we'll often go over to the coop and feed it to them. And they'll eat the worms too, but their contribution to the garden is so great that we'll let them get a couple worms if they want to. Their manure is the best stuff you can get. Just makes really rich compost. And they eat our weeds too. We pick the weeds and feed it to them. We have the bunny manure and the chicken manure that we use. It makes a compost tea. And then we have the leftovers from our organic snacks. Right back there in the corner is our compost bin, and we get compost out of that. It tends to make plants that are so healthy that they're more disease resistant to begin with. Nice. And if you get sort of out of the cycle of using, you know, Roundup and the things to spray to keep away the pests and just have really, really healthy, rich soil, then you're growing plants generally that you're not going to need those for anyway.
So Angela, thank you so much for having us here at the Rowanberry School.
It was great to have you guys. Thanks. It was a lot of fun. And Sarah, there's so much to learn.
And thanks for coming.
Mm-hmm. And I'm April Westfall here with Brain Stew Productions, bringing you the tools to be more sustainable today.
We're back in the studio here with Molly Chidsey from Multnomah County. Picking up the conversation where we left off, you were telling us about some of the things, you were scaring us about some of the things that we're exposed to. So tell us what's happening in the U.S. You alluded to some of the European initiatives. Mm-hmm. What's happening for us here in the U.S.?
Well, I think this is a really exciting time because I think we're starting to see a shift or a tipping point starting to approach, or maybe we've already gone across the tipping point. So we've got some good news to report. In the U.S., I'll talk a little bit about clean technology or clean tech as a business sector. You know, you might have heard that as a kind of a new buzz phrase, So manufacturing that makes products that are non-toxic or that are less toxic and better for human health and for the environment. So just a couple of quick facts on the economic side to show that we're really headed in the right direction with this stuff. Massachusetts companies in the 1990s, this is a Tufts study, and they added up all of the amounts of money that businesses in the state saved during the 90s just through basic pollution prevention, toxics reduction efforts. And they actually saved about $15 million. So it might not sound like a lot now, but consider that, you know, that was a decade ago when things were just kind of getting started. So I'll give you a more recent example. The clean technology sector for venture capitalists, so folks that really put, you know, a lot of money on new things that they see are a good bet, if you will.
Right.
That is actually clean technology, something in like maybe the top five different industries that are being invested in the past year, and that was a big increase over the previous year, and it's something like $3 trillion in investments currently and on the rise. So
it's really exciting when the market gets involved with making a difference.
And that's not just people who are trying to do the right thing. When you get that kind of money, it's because people have faith that it's economically viable.
That's right. That's right.
Exciting. Mm-hmm.
You mentioned buzzwords. I've heard the term precautionary principle a lot, and I know Multnomah County has now sort of adopted that. So why don't you tell us a little bit about what that means and why it's important and how it's going to be used?
I would be happy to. The precautionary principle is, in a sense, a way to make decisions. And it's kind of like a thoughtful way to prevent harm to human health and the environment. And it's kind of like the old adage, better safe than sorry. So instead of proving that a chemical or a product is safe or harmful after it's been on the market and after we've already been using it, instead it's kind of like taking a step back and being more on the preventive side and more cautious about the kinds of products that we allow to go to market and how we develop them in the first place, kind of like what we were talking about with clean technology.
But is it even practical to prove that something's safe for all organisms everywhere under all circumstances? How do you do that? That seems impractical.
That's a really good question. And, you know, the thing about the precautionary principle that I like so much and that I use in my work is that it sets in place a decision-making process, essentially. So it gets you asking some questions along the lines of, you know, what are the safest alternatives that I could be using as a component in this product or as an ingredient? And so it's a good way to involve the public and the community in helping to make that decision. Also a good way to make sure that those decisions are being made transparently. And so better safe than sorry is definitely something that is getting included in some policies like the REACH policy we talked about before. Right. And a couple of local governments are starting to pick up on it now. But again, it's a really good decision-making tool and can inform future policies.
So they managed to get that through in Europe, and it sounds like you're trying to use it in Multnomah County, but I can imagine there's going to be some resistance from major manufacturers who will ask the same question Darcy did about how do I prove that this is safe instead of having to prove it's damaged.
Yeah. So. Well, one of the things that we're working on in Multnomah County particularly is just on, you know, our own internal government operations. So really not trying to tackle community or businesses at this time, but it's really helpful to take a look at what kinds of products our government's buying, what kinds of things are we using in our public facilities, and again, like I said, you know, asking those questions ahead of time, shifting the burden of proof into manufacturers or onto vendors and just asking them, say, in requests for proposals, you know, give us some information about the safety of these products because we're really interested in the safety of our members of our community and also in our employees. And so really trying to open up the dialogue to asking more of those questions and then also setting an intention for buying the least toxic and least harmful product, if at all possible, where it's feasible, where they work well, where they're cost competitive, things like that.
And have you found that you're changing out many products as a result of that?
Well, in my own work at the county, the toxics reduction strategy is kind of just getting started. We adopted it as a work plan last year, and we are starting out with a couple of things that are a little bit more on the easy side, I'd say. We're trying to figure out ways to buy low mercury lamps for county facilities, and we're trying to figure out ways to limit access to the really strong disinfectants that are needed in some facilities, but not for all. So it's definitely going to be a process, and it'll take a while to get through all those actions, but we're learning a lot as we go, and we're involving a lot of employees along the way, so it's a good time.
I would hope you'd make that information available once you figure out what is the product that's safer, that if you start making that public, then other people can pile on and participate as well without having to do all the research.
It's a very collaborative process, and I wanted to mention that there's also some good examples from the private sector. There are some businesses that are making kind of voluntary decisions before the new regulations change. You know, I think we're probably going to see a shift toward kind of more responsible policies in this country, but before that happens, we're seeing some companies like Patagonia choosing organic cotton, for instance, or some footwear companies are choosing to source less toxic products to make those shoes. There's also third-party certification programs like Green Seal, which have great standards built right into the seal that say that, you know, there won't be these types of toxic products in there, and they're vetted out with industry before the standards are adopted, and it's a voluntary thing that a manufacturer can put as a seal on their product. So it's a good way to, as a consumer, either at home or at work, to try to find something that's better.
That does make it a lot easier for us when I go to the store to look for something like Green Seal.
Yeah.
And it makes such a difference to ask. I know we've had several clients who, in doing an assessment for them, went and talked to some of their vendors or people who worked with them, and they'd say, oh, they're interested in sustainability. I could have given them the green cleaning products. I could have given them the non-toxic paint. So the default is still to give people the toxic stuff because it's what people are used to using. So asking makes all the difference in the world. Yeah. So is there anything else locally that's going on that you'd like to share?
Sure. Well, I wanted to talk about this grassroots effort called the Safe Cosmetics Campaign. It's just a really, I think it's just a stellar example of a community effort that's really starting to make a difference. So they're working on both informing consumers on the types of chemicals, toxic chemicals that might be in personal care products, so things from lipstick to shampoo to lotions, deodorant, things like that. And also they're working on voluntary action by manufacturers to make those products safer. And they have a great website where you can get more information, and they're also working really actively with different manufacturers to try to educate them on why these products should be safer. And it's important because the FDA doesn't really have the tools right now to necessarily regulate all of the different ingredients, so it's really important.
Well, that's a fantastic lead into our next spotlight. You're talking about personal care products, and we'd like to take you to a company that cares very much about personal care products, and it's the Oregon Soap Company. We have a sample of their product right here. They're producing products that are not only safe for you and me to use, but also environmentally benign. So let's go with Katie Woods out into the field and get a peek at what's happening at Oregon Soap Company.
Well, hi, welcome. I'm Katie Wood, and today I am talking with Sat Atma from the Oregon Soap Company. Hi, how are you doing today?
I'm doing good, Katie. How are you?
I'm doing excellent, thanks. So what separates you from the other soap companies?
Well, there's a big difference between the soap that we make and the mass-produced soaps. The soap that Procter & Gamble and, you know, the big soap makers make is based on animal fat and petroleum byproducts. Their soap takes about 72 hours to make, where we use something called the cold process. It's a 5-week process. It makes the soap very, very mild, and they last much longer than ordinary soap. And in contrast to the other, like, sort of small-scale soap makers that are, you know, our direct competitors, we're using all organic vegetable oils, and we don't use any synthetic fragrances or colors or anything. It's as organic as it can be.
All right. Well, I'm really excited to see how you make all of this. So you want to show me? Are you ready?
All right.
Let's go.
All right, well, here we are in our soap shop. We're gonna make some soap today. We're gonna make peppermint soap here in this oil drum. And over here we have all the essential oils that we use to make soap and the different herbs. We also use an on-demand hot water heater. And this hot water heater only heats up water as we need it. So it uses just a very minimal amount of power.
So what do we do first when we make soap?
Well, first I have to put on my work clothes.
All right, well, let's get changed then. So this is stage two in soap making, right? After we got our protective gear on?
Right. Right here we have a pot of vegetable oil. We make all of our soap out of organic vegetable oil instead of animal fat, like most soap is made out of. These are all our trimmings from our last batch of soap. So we're just going to put this in the new batch, and it'll reform real nicely into new soap. So that way we don't have any waste. There's almost no waste. We use almost every last little piece of soap. Actually, down at the Saturday market, we take all of our scraps and leftover odd-sized pieces that don't get turned into soap again, and people buy those. Right now, we're going to filter the oil and make sure that there's no big chunks of unmelted oil. You can actually make soap out of any kind of fat or oil. You know, then the old pioneers used to make it out of their bacon drippings and stuff like that. We use three oils, palm and coconut and olive oil. Palm oil just makes a really nice, good, solid soap. Coconut oil makes soap suds. And then the olive oil is great for your skin. All right, now we're gonna check our temperatures. With our particular formula, the lye and the vegetable oil need to be within 3 degrees of each other. So our lye is now at 87.5 degrees. Then we'll go over here and check out our vegetable oil. So our vegetable oil is now at 93.5 degrees. So we need to heat up our lye just a little bit more before we mix the two together. And all the scents all come from essential oils, which are plant-based as opposed to synthetic fragrances, which are again, chemical compounds that often have a difficult time biodegrading. So this is peppermint oil from the Yakima Valley up in Washington. It is a little more challenging using the essential oils than perfume oils because most of our soaps are blends of 2, 3, 4, or 5 different essential oils, so it takes some time to get the blending right. You know, in the very beginning, we experimented a little bit with some of the perfume oils, and they gave me a headache to work with, and I didn't think they smelled good. And yeah, we figured out pretty early on that we just wanted to work with the plant-based. So we're going to add our lye to our vegetable oil. As you can see, I got a face mask on because you don't want to get this in your eyes. And you can see the vegetable oils are already starting to change colors, getting thick and milky because it's turning into soap.
So what is soap? How does it work?
Soap is a very interesting molecule that's very long and skinny. And one side of the molecule sticks to dirt and grease, and the other side sticks to water. So basically when you're using soap, it's like an electromagnetic bond that bonds the dirt to the water. And you know how when you put a drop of water on your skin, it just stays as a drop? Soap actually releases the tension between the water molecules so that the water and the soap can get down in your skin or in your clothing to get you clean. About a half a gallon of essential oil we put in there. So the soap's done.
All right, so besides the benefits it has for our skin, what type of impact does it have on the environment when you make it?
Mother Nature already has mechanisms built into it that will break down plant-based natural materials as opposed to synthetic ingredients, which are often very complex, big, long chemicals that Mother Nature has more of a difficult time breaking down. So just by the nature of the ingredients that we use, you know, they biodegrade much quicker than most products that are out there.
By using your soap, you're also offsetting CO2 emissions because of the carbon offsetting.
We work with a group called Carbon Fund. It's carbonfund.org. And you can get onto Carbon Fund and you can calculate your own carbon footprint. And so that the carbon that we're using in the production of the soap gets offset by the planting of trees is how I'm really into reforestation projects. And we actually aim to offset at least 150% of our carbon usage. So instead of just being carbon neutral I guess it would be carbon negative, to where there's a little bit less carbon greenhouse gases that are produced, that are out there when you buy a bar soap. Because I think that going carbon neutral at this point isn't enough. You know, we need to actually be reducing the greenhouse gases that we're creating. That's only going to happen by everybody actually taking out a little bit more than they're putting in. So we use renewable power and all the in the soap shop as well, and we offset our driving and our air travel that we have to do a couple times a year. And then what you can't reduce to nothing, then we offset. So this is the curing room, and this is where all the soap dries. Soap actually goes through a 5-week process where it's curing. Here we have this big block of soap gets cut into these smaller pieces where they sit here for a couple weeks. Then they get trimmed up into bars like this.
What happens in the curing process?
During the curing process, the water evaporates from the soap, which makes it harder and more long-lasting. And the chemistry of the soap actually takes that long to complete, to actually turn this into a bar of pure soap.
So now we're going to take this 200-pound block of soap and cut it into bricks, right?
Yes.
All right, let's cut some soap.
All right.
How exciting! So first we're just taking the sides off, right?
Yeah, we're going to take...
expose the block.
Right.
So how many different kinds of essence are there, soaps, do you make?
We currently make 22 different kinds of soap, of bar soap, and then we're in the process of making liquid soap as well, and we have about 3 different kinds of liquid soap.
So right now it's just body soap. Do you make like a facial soap or hand soap? Or
There's one of those scents that works really great for the hands. It's a cinnamon soap that's really good for like cutting grease and dirt, and then they all work pretty good for the face. There's one in particular called honey and oatmeal soap, which is a particularly good face soap.
What's your favorite?
I like the Bay Rum.
The Bay Rum?
Yeah.
What do you find is the most popular?
Lavender is definitely the most popular soap.
Yeah, that is always a popular fragrance.
Yeah. This big bar of soap, which is kind of odd shaped, and you can see has lots of soap left over on the top. A piece like this will actually get taken to the Saturday market, and we'll sell it in our scrap soap area, which everybody loves because they're like half price. So we just use some tools that a friend of mine made for us, and we shave off the top of the soap. And we'll throw these on a screen here to dry out as well.
So these tools are nice because they really make the soap same size.
Yeah. So this is the final cut. We're going to turn this big brick of soap into 16 small bars of soap.
Push them down.
Uh-huh.
Is this another homemade piece of machinery?
Yeah, it's another homemade piece of soap equipment. Now these are going to cure for 5 weeks. I'd like them not to touch so the air can circulate between them. Looks great.
All right. So the final process of making soap is the packaging, correct?
That's correct. Our favorite way to sell soap is actually with no packaging. And people come into the stores and just cut off however much they want.
Save a few trees that way.
Yeah, save a few trees. We also sell it with our minimal packaging that just has a simple wraparound, it's called a cigar band label on it. Or some of the grocery stores like to have it boxed up, so we have a nice box that the soap goes into.
And you do all of this yourself, right?
Well, this is the soap elves do lots
the
of this.
The soap elves.
Yeah, they do the soap
do
wrapping.
It. I'm going to wrap one myself here.
Okay.
That way I can be considered an elf. Well, Sat Atma, thank you so much for showing us around and making soap with me. I had a great time.
All right. Thanks, Katie.
Yeah, of course. And I'm Katie Wood with Sustainable Today, bringing you tools today to make you more sustainable.
Well, thanks so much to Oregon Soap for giving us such a wonderful bar. I'm hoping that we can split this up amongst us and take some of it home. It smells wonderful. I think most people don't realize that when you, you know, everything that goes down your drain ends up in the river, and so it matters what you wash your hair with, what you wash your body with, drain cleaners, all those things. So we always like to, at this part of the show, tell our viewers what they can do at home and at work to make a difference, and obviously switch to non-toxic or bio-based products. That will help a lot. And there are cleaning products, personal care products, weed and pest control. There's something in almost every product category. If you can't find it at your store, ask for non-toxic products to let your vendors know that you care. When you buy furnishings, look for non-toxic furnishings and building materials. Watch out in particularly for flame retardants or stain, you know, stuff that's covered to keep stains off, things like that. Use the products as they are directed. Actually, read the instructions, follow the instructions, and dispose of the materials properly. A lot of homeowners don't measure things carefully, and so that can lead to all sorts of problems. Research your purchases. We're going to give you, at the end of the show, a bunch of great websites that will help you research your purchases. Since another way that you can protect yourself and your family is to buy organic food, you can radically reduce the amount of pesticides that you're ingesting by doing that. So those are things that you can do at home. Marcia, what are things that people can do at work?
Well, even in the workplace, there are some obvious things like starting a recycling system for chemical products. Some of the companies that we've worked with have even enabled their employees to bring some of those difficult-to-recycle things to work, like batteries and thermometers, and so accepting them in a central location. I'm getting a nod from Molly, so it must be a good idea. Obviously, asking your janitorial service to switch to greener cleaning products. If you remodel for your business, to consider low VOC paints and fabrics without the flame retardants, those kinds of things. You can ask your architect or your contractor about them. They should know. If they don't know, perhaps you need a different architect or contractor. Doing a chemical inventory in, you know, even if you're not a manufacturer, likely you're using chemicals in your business, if nothing else, toners, printer inks, things like that. And making sure that you have the material safety data sheets available and read them, because they're fairly informative. You can also vet your chemical list or the things that you're using. We've worked with organizations that create what they call blacklists and gray lists. The blacklists are the chemicals that they're trying to phase out. Using native plants and also an environmentally preferable purchasing product.
So, Molly, you've identified a bunch of great websites, so quickly tell us about them.
Oh, I'd love to. Well, you know, it's really easy if you have access to the internet these days to really become informed and educate yourself on a couple of these different things. And it doesn't have to be scary, because most of the websites actually do give you some ideas for things that you can do in your everyday life to reduce your exposure to toxic. So I wanted to bring your attention to a couple. Let's see, healthycar.org is brand new if you're going to be buying a car. It has to do with the toxic chemicals that are in new cars. New car smell, not such a good thing. if you're looking for information about a specific toxic chemical, you can go to scorecard.org. That's always a good one to look things up. And there's a new one along the same lines called Toxipedia, kind of like Wikipedia, but all about toxics for us toxics nerds out there. And for kind of the everyday person, if you're just interested in a little bit more information, I would suggest a couple of great websites that are on the National Institute of Health website. One's called ToxTown, and it's this interactive map. You can find out where toxics are in an everyday community, and also ToxMap, where you can kind of look up in your own community what the concerns might be.
More than you ever may want to know. Huh? And then there's the Safe Cosmetics website as well, right?
That's right. I believe it's safecosmetics.org, and there are also other ones that are for personal care products specifically. And if you're most interested in health, you can check out healthandenvironment.org.
Great.
It's good too.
Thank you. Well, we want to thank you again for being with us tonight. It was a fascinating show, and hopefully our viewers picked up some things that they can start doing to become more sustainable today. And we hope you'll join us for our next couple of shows. This summer we're featuring food, since it's going to be harvest season. So thank you all for joining us. Hope you learned something. We'll see you next month.
There's a big, beautiful planet in the sky. It's my home. It's where I live. You
and many others live here too. The earth is our home, it's where we live. We can feel the power of the noonday sun, a blazing ball of fire up above. Shining light and warmth enough for everyone, a gift to every nation from a star. It's a big, beautiful planet in the sky. It's my home, it's where I live. You and many others live here too. The earth is our home, it's where we live.
Hi, I'm Kelly Danielson. We're here at the Green Renaissance Festival talking to Gordon Westfall about marketing sustainability. Hi, Gordon. How are you doing?
Thank you so much. I'm doing well.
Good. Can you tell us a little bit about what we're doing here today?
Well, you know, as a nonprofit, we produce a cable television show called Sustainable Today, which is what we're here doing right now, filming for that show. But that's only one thing that we can do to get to the people. What we feel is coming to these kinds of events gives us a one-on-one interaction. We can get up close and personal with people and have dialogue and communication. We can ask questions, we can answer questions, and really get to the heart of what sustainability and self-sufficiency really is. What we do is we bring you the tools to be sustainable today, not tomorrow. And basically we are a 501c3 here in Oregon City, Oregon, Portland metropolitan area. What we really need to start doing is looking at the mindset. We need to start looking at the habits people are doing and what they're eating and how they're functioning in society. So got together with a number of people in the nonprofit, and I came up with the Circle of Sustainable Today. So now that we've got everybody tuned in to sustainability, and people want to put in the rain catchment system, and they want to, you know, do permaculture, and they want to figure out how to compost, and you might think, well, How do you do all that? How do I start with this? It starts with you. What you have to do is plug into your community. You have to have outreach projects. So what we did is we have an Atkinson Park chemical-free park.
I've been at pulling ivy for about 10 years.
So the reason why the Center for Sustainable Today has taken on this project with Atkinson Park is that we feel strongly that our kids and the animals that we have, we should make sure that they have a place to go, that we don't have to worry about them having chemicals in their systems or being, you know, susceptible to harmful chemicals. We've taken it upon ourselves to bring it, come in and prevent chemicals from being sprayed in this park. No herbicides, no pesticides in this park whatsoever. We want the city to say, you have a green space as long as you do the work. Another outreach mechanism that we have was this Trails Crossing bench. This is a bench that was created in Oregon City. It's a bus stop on a corner that was neglected. So what we did is we came through with the City Repair Project and created a partnership with City Repair and Christ the Healers, which is a nonprofit that owns that land there. And this is all volunteers. And what this did is empowered our neighborhood. It empowered the people to get involved and get to know each other.
You created something lasting and sustainable and linking form and function, linking art and usage, linking people in really wonderful ways. So it's with a great deal of pride that on behalf of the citizens of Oregon City, I am participating to help dedicate this in perpetuity for our community.
Well, Gordon, I want to thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us today about the center, and good luck in the future.
Thanks so much.
Thank you. I'm Kelly Danielson, bringing you the tools to be sustainable today.